Happy Sabbath Journey. As many of you know, my name is Jesus Vera. I am the intern pastor here at Journey SDA, and I'm super excited to be sharing the word with you guys today. I want to thank you guys for tuning in, and I also wanted to remind you guys, if you're wanting to give back, you can do so by going to our website at journeysda.org and clicking the tab that says Give. Or you can text Journey SDA Give to the following number, 77977. You're also going to see it displayed somewhere around here. I'm not sure where I'm going to put it yet, but you can go ahead and text that number if you're wanting to give back. Also, don't forget to follow us on Instagram and friend us on Facebook. And of course, make sure to like, comment, and subscribe to our YouTube channel as we're dropping sermons every single Sabbath. And we're getting pretty consistent with our Sabbath school discussions as well. So you don't want to miss out on that. But anyways, now that the formalities are out of the way, let's go ahead and open up with a word of prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, I just want to thank you for this time. I want to thank you for this presence. I want to thank you, God, because you continue to provide a way for us to be a community. God, you continue to provide ways where your gospel can be preached, where your good word can be preached, God. And so with that being said, God, I ask, God, that I be filled with your presence, that I be filled with your spirit, God, and that there may be ears to hear the following word, God, and that you may open up the hearts and the minds of everyone listening, God. And may you open up my heart and my mind as well, God, for what you have to say, God. God, I want to thank you once again for your holy day. I want to thank you for your Sabbath, God. I want to thank you for everyone watching, God. I ask that you be of a blessing to them. I ask that you be a blessing to their families, God. And God, just want to thank you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen, amen. I want you to picture the following image in your head. Imagine it's a snowy day and you're alone out in a hike. You're well prepared though, don't worry. You have your snow boots, you have on multiple layers, you even have your backpack with some snacks, maybe even your hydro flask. Maybe even you brought a thermo with you. You got a nice little hot chocolate and the snow is just right. You've been posting all day on your Instagram story, so all your friends, all your family, everyone who is stuck at home is super jealous of you because they wish they would be at the snow. After a little bit, maybe 1 or 2 hours, you decide, you know what, I hiked enough. I got the pictures I wanted. I got the people jealous, the people I wanted to get jealous. I got them jealous. And so you decide it's time to head back home. But just as you start to head back, the snow begins to pick up. You look at your phone to see if there's a snowstorm coming, but you've lost connection. You begin to get a little worried at this point, but you know your way back well enough that you start to pick up the pace before a snowstorm hits. But it picks up too fast. Wind is blowing. Everything is covered in white. You can hardly see what's in front of you. And suddenly, out of nowhere, you hear some rumbling in the background. You turn around, but you can't see a single thing, so you decide to shout out, "Hey, is anybody there?" Maybe it's a fellow hiker that also got caught up in the snowstorm, but silence replies. Then you hear some more rumbling as a vague shadow passes through your peripheral vision. And as you turn around quickly, right in front of you is a mountain lion staring back at you. Terrifying, I know, but what do you do? Or better yet, what can you do? I want to invite you to look at 2 Samuel chapter 23, verse 20 with me. There was also Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, a valiant warrior from Kabzeel. He did many heroic deeds, which included killing two of Moab's mightiest warriors. And on a snowy day, he chased the lion down into a pit and killed it. Benaiah is considered to be one of David's mighty warriors, who eventually became a commander in David's army. And he too was faced with the lion on a snowy day. So what did he do when it was just him and the lion in that storm? Scripture said he chased it and killed it. But let's look at this story with some logic. A human is not faster than a lion. A human cannot possibly chase a lion and catch up to it. It's just not physically possible. A lion can run up to 50 miles per hour, while a human at best can do 20 miles per hour. So here on a snowy day, we have Benaiah coming face to face with the lion. I don't know what he did in that moment. I'm sure that the lion let out its mightiest roar in an attempt to scare Benaiah. Yet Benaiah did something to scare that lion off into a chase. And here's what I find interesting. You would think after scaring off the lion, Benaiah would go in the opposite direction, fleeing from the danger that could have and would have killed him. Yet he did the complete opposite. Benaiah went for the hunt. He most likely followed the footprints in the snow, looking to see where the lion was hiding. And sure enough, the prince led Benaiah into a pit, or in other words, a cave. Now, can someone please explain the logic behind this? Why on earth would you follow a lion into a cave? Benaiah stared into the cave, knowing, into the dark cave, by the way, knowing that somewhere in there was a lion that moments ago wanted to devour him. Benaiah walks into the cave, and the snowstorm is still strong outside, and the further he walks into the cave, the darker it gets. Eventually, Benaiah sees is pitch black until he sees big yellow eyes staring right back at him. Out of nowhere, the lion lets out another roar. Benaiah screams, and for a moment after, there is complete silence. And the question we are all asking, who comes out of that cave? Well, scripture tells us it's Benaiah, of course. I mean, it doesn't literally tell us, but I can imagine Benaiah walking out with blood on his clothes. Maybe he's holding a piece of the lion's mane, or maybe he's walking out with the lion's tooth as a souvenir to add to his collection of battles. It's a crazy story, I know, but there is much to be learned here. It's without a doubt that Benaiah was a lion chaser, and so the question arises, what does it mean to be a lion chaser in our lives? You see, every time you chase the lions in your life, those things that terrify you, those things that you cannot seem to escape, every time you chase them down, and it becomes a life or death situation. It's the decision of a lifetime. It changes your life. Benaiah went from being one of David's mightiest men to being commander-in-chief of Israel. And I strongly believe it has to do with the decision of him chasing down the lion. That decision was a decisive moment in his life that set the trajectory for his future. Oftentimes, many Christians believe that God is real, but very few people actually live that reality. And it's because there is a huge gap between our theology or our beliefs, or maybe even our doctrines, and our reality. Too many times we allow our circumstances to get in between God and us, instead of letting God get in between our circumstances and us. Now look, I'm not saying we need to literally chase lions, but there are things in our lives that are limiting our belief not only in God, but also in ourselves. Maybe it's something that happened in our past. Maybe it's the fear of failure. Maybe it's just this whole pandemic. Maybe it was just the year 2020 and still 2021. And look, I don't blame you. I really don't. I'm with you. But at what point do we begin to live our lives with meaning? At what point do we begin to live with courage? At what point do we begin to live in freedom? You want to know what distinguishes Benaiah? It's a simple fact that he measured every circumstance in his life. He measured every failure in his life. He measured every problem in his life. He measured everything against God Almighty, including 500-pound lions. And this is a lesson that I want us to learn today. Measure everything against God Almighty. Every problem, every worry, every stress, every cry, every pain, every failure, everything against God Almighty. And I promise you, God comes out winning every single time. But I get it, Pastor. It's easier said than done. Trust, I get it. It does take a lot of faith to stare a lion down in the face and decide to chase it. It does take a lot of faith to stare down fear and failure in the face and decide to chase it. It takes a lot of faith to stare your past down in the face and decide to chase it. It takes a lot of faith to step into the call God has for us. And it's funny because I think of the Israelites when they had to flee Egypt. We all know the story. Moses is called to free his people, and after a plague or two, the Israelites are finally free, but it does not take long for their fears to consume their freedom. They cry out to Moses early on in chapter 14 of Exodus, and they tell Moses they would rather live as slaves, they would rather live in shackles, they would rather live in chains than die living freely in the presence of God. They would rather live under the oppression of Pharaoh than measure their current circumstance against God Almighty. And I love what God responds in Exodus chapter 14, verse 15. It says, "Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to move on.'" God gave no comfort. God gave no avail. God simply demanded that the Israelites move on and place their trust in God and God alone. He told them not to look back, and there are things in our lives that we must leave behind and never look back if we truly want to live freely in God's presence. Benaiah faced the lion. The Israelites faced Pharaoh. What is it that you're facing, and why haven't you moved on? Why haven't you chased it down and killed it yet? It's not every Sabbath that you hear these questions, but we are living in such a pivotal time in our history, not just for Christianity, but for humanity. And I'm with you. It's scary. I know, Pastor, it's scary. But God is calling us. God needs us to be a light and beacon of hope. God Almighty is waiting to grant deliverance, but God is calling for our help. And for that to happen, we must step through our pain. We must step through our scars. We must step through our fears. We must step through our failures and step into the new life that God is calling us to live. God is calling us to become lion chasers. And I don't know how to put this any clearer, but if you're watching this and you're hearing the words I'm saying today, I'm saying that it's time. It's time you step fully into the life God has planned for you. You may not know what it is yet, but you feel it. You know God is calling you. You know there are things you have to move on from. You know there are things you have to leave in the past. You know there are lines that you've been avoiding in your life. And I think it's time we step into faith and truly believe nothing can stand against God Almighty. But how do you know that? How do you know that, Pastor? I don't know. I really don't know what it was for Benaiah. Or I don't know what it was for the Israelites that allowed them to have trust in God. But I can tell you why I know that nothing can stand against God Almighty. I can tell you why I measure all my fears, all my insecurities, all my worries, all my pain, and all my failures against God. And it's because God decided that nothing would ever stand against me and God's love. Through Jesus Christ, I see the full expression of God's love. I see the full expression of what God did. I see God making the impossible possible, and I see God putting it all on the line. For God to do what God did through Jesus Christ, I don't see why any lion, why any oppressor, why any fear, why anything in this universe would stand against God and I. So I choose to live my life chasing every lion, no matter how big or how small, because I know that nothing can stand against God's love, and I know that nothing can stand against God Almighty. This is my invitation to you. For you watching this at home, for you watching this in your car, wherever you may be watching this, this is my invitation. No more living in fear. God was there for Benaiah. God was there for the Israelites, and God is here now for you too. Let us move on and live freely in God's presence. Pray with me. Heavenly Father God, I want to thank you for the example of Benaiah. I want to thank you for the example of the Israelites, God. And I want to thank you for the example of our experiences, God. At this moment, God, I just want to pray for myself and for who's ever watching, God, that you may lift us from our insecurities, that you may lift us from our anxieties, from our worries, from our pain, from our scars, from our past, God. And may you move us into the calling, God, into the life, into the future that you have planned for us, God. God, I know that some of us must be scared, God. I know that some of us may not be ready, God. But I ask, God, that you fill us with your presence, God. That you fill us with your freedom, God. And that you fill us with your love, God. And lastly, God, I want to thank you, God, for the love you've displayed in Jesus Christ, for Emmanuel, for God with us. God, thank you so much, God. I ask that you one more time be a blessing for who's ever watching this, God. And may we step into your future, into your life, into your presence. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you one more time for tuning in with us this Sabbath. Make sure to like, make sure to comment, make sure to subscribe, make sure to follow us on Instagram, make sure to friend us on Facebook, make sure to send this sermon to a friend or a family member who you think needs to hear this message. Happy Sabbath, and God bless.